subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Is India too dependent on the US regards its Afghanistan policy, and is that affecting its status as a regional power? Now, everybody's talking about Afghanistan these days, and these are only some of the questions that I will attempt to answer in this edition of Global Print. But before that, dear viewer, I'd like to make an appeal to you. Please do consider subscribing and paying just a little bit for the prints, free, fair, objective and unhyphenated journalism. You know that we have been bringing to you the best news videos, the best stories over the last several months of the pandemic. So please do continue to support us. You will find in the description of this video links to subscribe both for an international audience as well as for a domestic one. So please do click on the join button, pay just a little bit. It's very little money, only ₹159, but you will get an array of benefits that non-subscribers do not have. Now back to my column Global Print, in which I talk about Afghanistan. Of course, it's the most important story on the international agenda. Everybody is talking about it, whether it's in the US, in India, in Pakistan, in China. Now these are the various countries that have not just an interest but a role in what happens in that country. So in this fast-moving situation, let me just put down a few points. The first is, as we know, the former Afghan president, Ashraf Ghani, he fled Afghanistan some days ago, in fact, exactly a week ago, in the company of his national security advisor, Hamdullah Mohib, and the director of his office, Fazal Fazli. They have since landed in the UAE. The UAE sheikhs are saying that they will allow him to stay there on humanitarian grounds, so we still don't know what their final destination is going to be. Second is that the Indian ambassador, Rudrendra Tandon, has been evacuated along with all the other diplomats as well as staff in the Indian embassy, as well as two journalists, including my colleague Nainima Basu, and you will see her reports in the print, so do consider reading them and watching her videos. Several other Indian civilians who have been staying on, who have been in Afghanistan these last several months and years working there, there was some problem in their evacuation, but they since have left Kabul and they are on their way to India. And External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar has been in New York at the United Nations Security Council these last few days, addressing an emergency session of the UNSC on Afghanistan. You know, dear viewer, that India is the president of the United Nations Security Council this month in August in its capacity as a non-permanent member of the Security Council. So India has taken advantage of that position to call an emergency session on Afghanistan. In fact, the second one these past couple of weeks. Now, Mr. Jaishankar has also been speaking to his counterparts in the US, Antony Blinken, as well as in Germany, to get a sense not just of the situation in Afghanistan, but also how to evacuate Indian nationals from there. You know that there has been a big, big crisis at Kabul airport, which is held by the Americans, but thousands and thousands of Afghans, as well as foreigners who have been trying to get out of there. The outer perimeter is held by the Taliban. So it is a big task to get across that outer perimeter and into the inner sanctum of Kabul airport so that flights are allowed to take off. Now, the other big news is that while the Indian ambassador has returned, the Russian, the Chinese and the Pakistani ambassadors have stayed back. And some of this is also due to the fact that the Russians, who have invested a great deal of time and effort in creating a relationship with the Pakistanis, who of course have enormous influence on the Taliban. And here I will quote to you what the Russian embassy spokesperson in Kabul, Nikita Ishenko, described the manner in which Ashraf Ghani fled from Kabul last week. He talked about the collapse of the regime, which is most characterized by the way Ghani fled from Afghanistan. Four cars were full of money. They tried to put part of the money into the helicopter, but everything did not fit. And some of the money was left on the runway. Now, this is the Russian press person in Kabul, in the Kabul embassy, describing to you the manner in which Ashraf Ghani fled. And certainly this has angered Afghans and people all over the world, because the manner in which the Afghan government collapsed, the Afghan army collapsed, has been the subject of much discussion this past week. But there's another equally interesting development that has taken place inside Afghanistan, and this is Amrullah Saleh, the former first vice president to Ashraf Ghani, has now declared himself the caretaker president of the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan. He is in the Panjshir Valley, which is his home. Remember that Amrullah Saleh was a very young aide, barely 25 years old, in 2001 when Ahmed Shah Massoud, the Lion of Panjshir, he is often known as that, or Commander Massoud, fought the Taliban, did not give up the last redoubt in the Panjshir Valley, never gave up to the Taliban until he was assassinated on the 9th of September 2001. And 2 days later, of course, the Taliban hits various American cities, including New York and Washington, D.C., and more than 3,000 people are killed. So Ahmed Shah Massoud fighting the Taliban till the very end from the Panjshir Valley, and Commander Massoud's son, Ahmed Massoud, along with Amrullah Saleh, are now back in the Panjshir Valley, promising Afghans that they will fight till the bitter end. But in what is an equally interesting development, the brother of Commander Massoud, Ahmed Zia Massoud, has now gone to Pakistan. Now, Ahmed Zia Massoud is in the company of several former leaders of the Northern Alliance, which Commander Massoud led with such distinction. And these include the former Speaker of the Afghan Parliament, Yunus Kanuni, Hazara leaders like Ustad Muhakkik and Karim Khalili. And we know that the Taliban have already undertaken a few massacres or killed some Hazara leaders in July, weeks, a month before they took Kabul. So the question that you would ask is, why have these Tajik and Hazara leaders, who the Taliban cannot stand, why have they gone to Pakistan? And this is the question, again, which we will continue to answer over the next few weeks and months as the situation in Afghanistan becomes much more clear. So what went wrong? Now, this is a question, of course, that all of America and the rest of the world is asking. But Christine Fair, a noted South Asia expert with Georgetown University, who writes in Foreign Policy magazine, has said the following, that Joe Biden, when he was the vice president of Barack Obama in the former Obama administration, had benefited from a raft of experts. And she talks about how Pakistan, which benefited handsomely from U.S. emoluments, aided and abetted the Taliban and undermined U.S. efforts. Now, this is coming out more and more since Kabul fell to the Taliban. Several experts around the world are speaking about this, but Christine Fair talks about how Joe Biden, although he had access to the best advice on Afghanistan, as well as the role that Pakistan's strategic and military establishment played in the takeover of Kabul, says that Biden, implies that Biden ignored that advice. In fact, she talks about how Biden chose to keep Zalmay Khalilzad, the U.S. special envoy who he inherited from the Donald Trump administration. Since then, of course, we know that Donald Trump has been very critical of the manner in which Joe Biden has been dealing with the Afghan situation. And he has talked about at length in the manner of which he dealt with the Taliban. And he said he understood very clearly the games that were afoot, that the games that the Taliban was playing, and that he never allowed them to get one up on the Americans. And he says, not just he, but a raft of other U.S. experts have said that this is a disaster that the Joe Biden administration and America will never forget over the next several decades. So keep watching and reading the print. We have a series of reports from Afghanistan from my colleague Nani Mambasu, who was there for a full 10 days, as well as analysis by experts from all over the world. And I look forward to your comments on this video. Thank you so much for watching.